1. You are live, you are live.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Sunset Safari. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have VM on camera. We have Jamie and Dangerous Dave out on the other vehicle. And we have Louise and Geraldine in final control. It is a scorching 34 degrees Celsius, 92 Fahrenheit. So really, really still on a hot late summer's afternoon, barely movement in the bush. Now Jamie's on her way to see if she can get a visual of Mr. Tingala, who we excitingly saw catching, but saw him dragging that male impala he caught. And as I mentioned towards the end of the sunrise safari, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt today. So not going to give too much away, but what'll happen is Jamie's going to place some eggs out in the bush for VM, myself, and all of you to find with some clues and some riddles. And we're going to do the same, and then Jamie and Dave will try find from the other side. So VM and I have been thinking hard about where we're going to hide our eggs, but don't worry, we don't have eggs. We just used some hard-boiled eggs that the final control ladies kindly painted. And VM's thinking about showing you. I think we should keep them hidden for now. VM's very, very sneakily holding an egg. But we will be hiding them. So you guys are going to have to help us find them through the clues that the other guide gives us. Okay, so I'm just taking a gander. I didn't come through this area this morning. Just checking if there aren't any possible tracks, see if Shadow came back into the area. And also we'll head down towards to see if Kruger has crossed back into Juma as well. Just a general maneuver around to see what's been happening. Because of course we were quite focused in one area this morning when we're tracking Mr. Tingana, and it was quite thrilling to be able to find a big cat on foot with an impala in his mouth. But yeah, let's continue on. This feels like a very much more of a dry heat than we have been experiencing. No big storm clouds on the horizon. And I am definitely suspecting that our rains might be over for the year, or for this part of the year. And I think next time we're going to be expecting any significant rain is going to be maybe in November, early November at this year. So we'll see what happens. But it is wonderful to be driving around in this greenery. Now I'm hoping that there's going to be a nice herd of ellies somewhere about here. But no one has been splashing in the pan. There's an elephant track, so we are in the right vicinity. Hopefully they haven't meandered it too far. It's amazing on these really hot late summer afternoons how quiet the bush is. There's very few birds making a noise, but also the only thing moving about, and even then not in great numbers, are the butterflies that I can see. I've seen a few butterflies, but nothing particularly spectacular just yet. Of course, it's always spectacular to be out here on Juma Private Game Reserve. And a little piece of paradise we're privileged enough to live in. Oh, well, there at least is something with a heartbeat. The It is a Cape turtle dove. And even he's in the shade. Taking advantage of the numerous grass seeds that have sprung after our late rain. There we go. Peck, peck, peck. Off he goes. Look at that. Now, one of my favorite little things, unfortunately, not too much uses in terms of medicinal uses or interesting facts, just a very, very pretty little thing. There we go. Now, it's called a hemalia, or a pink bell. And I'll just put it like this so you can see. Look at those exquisite colors. Let me just get my shadow out of the way of the inside of that hemalia. Now you can see why it's called a pink bell. So it sits like this. So there we go, it hangs down like a bell. A very pretty flower. And you can see those bright colors will attract various different insects. And it's amazing how all the different flower species have their insides specially arranged to suit certain insect species. Now, I've seen moths and butterflies on hemanias. I haven't really seen any of the bee flies or other wasps or other insects that pollinate on these particular things. So I think this might be a specialist for butterflies and moths. So I thought I saw a dash of color flying across here. Just trying to see where it flew off to. It's a bit far, but it has flown off there, right on top. I'm definitely going to try find a closer one. Where is that?
Who's going to be the in charge there, Ebs?
A lilac-breasted roller. But unfortunately, that one dashed a little bit far. Well, isn't that fascinating? On the Sunrise Safari with Jamie and Jandre, you got to see one doing that distinct rolling flight display. That's where they get their name from. So, fascinating stuff. Now, they're going to be with us the whole year. They're not one of the summer migrants who's going to head off to warmer climes in North and Central Africa, or even as far as Russia and Mongolia. Some of our eagle species will actually migrate all the way to Russia and Mongolia when we start getting a little bit chilly. And I think quite a few of the, some of the vagrants have already, or migrants rather than vagrants, have already disappeared. The European swallow or barn swallow is the most obvious one that is not around anymore. And there's definitely a lot less woodland kingfishers around. We're not hearing that constant throughout the day. And the Warburg's eagles, they should also be departing quite shortly. We've still got some European bee eaters around, but I haven't seen a carmine in quite a while.
I'm going to go to the next one.
So, welcome to Goo, who's a new viewer on YouTube, but a new South African viewer. So, welcome on the Sunset Safari. Goo says, the autumn weather is wonderful, not too hot. Well, Goo, I think, I'm not sure where you are, but it's definitely a few shades hotter than Hades, where we are at the moment. So it is still quite hot, but that's the joy of the Lowveld. One of the reasons I do enjoy residing down here. I really don't like cold weather. I'd much rather be hot and sweaty than cold and shivering. And you will see, if you keep watching, Goo, how many layers I can possibly put on as we head towards June, July, and the temperature plummets to about, oh, normally when we get going in the morning, 4 or 5 degrees. But with the open vehicle, the wind chill is quite impressive. And, well, I've at least got a nice big engine between me. The cameramen, however, have it a little bit colder, sitting up on their pedestal there. What have we got there? Sorry, just saw something on the road. I just wanted to double check. Ah, no, false alarm. It is a CFM can get to show you on camera. It's going to be quite difficult. It's in the shade there. Let's try. You see that track there, Vim, just off the edge of where I stopped. There we go. Ooh, you can't really see it clearly, but there's a tail and some little claw marks that have been walking across there. And that is a bushveld-plated lizard tracks. Bushveld-plated lizard. And we have quite an interesting little grass species here. Now, grass is very important out in the bush. Now, but depending on your soil types, depends on what type of grasses you get, and depending on what type of grasses you get, depends on how many animals you get. So the more of your decreaser grass species, which are good for animals to eat, the more zebra and wildebeest and impala and things you have, so the more predators you have. This particular one is called Panicum maximum, or blue guinea grass, or blue buffalo grass, lots of different names. The scientific name is Panicum. Now, I quite like it. Normally, in the rainy season, it forms these incredibly thick clumps. And I always found it quite ironic that it's named Panicum maximum, because when you've got to go track a lion or a leopard into this impenetrable grass that's as tall as me and you can barely see in it, you panic to the maximum. But also, another one of the reasons I like this grass species so much is it's very tasty. So, very high sugar content, so quite nice and sweet to chew on. I'll spend many, many hours wandering around the bush, chewing on Panicum. Okay, while I chew on my Panicum, let's go see what Jamie's up to. I think she might have arrived at Mr. Tingana. So, unfortunately, it seems like Jamie's gremlins are continuing to plague her, or Wendy's gremlins. So, she's going to try reposition now and see if she can get some picture there. So, till then, are you stuck with me and my Panicum? Now we've got a really nice vista of very typical South African Lowveld bush for this part of the world. So if we look here now, the correct terminology for the type of bush we are in at the moment is what you call broad-leaved woodland, and it's made up, the majority of the tree species are combretums or bush willows. So this is a very typical undulating mixed woodland, and in between, let me just see where we're looking up, you can see, where's my finger, Vim, if I come in? Oh, there's my grass. So in amongst the shorter combretums, you've got some bigger acacia nigrescens or knob thorns. And then you can see how they stick out. But almost 90%, there's another acacia there. And these are all multiple different species of bush willows in front of us. We've got red bush willow, russet bush willow, variable bush willow, large fruited bush willow. So very, very typical. And then up where we're sitting, we're right on the edge of the crest, and we actually have a nice little open grassland patch here, and this is quite common in this woodland. And we get these terminalias, or silver cluster leaves. Now, they're a very good indicator species of two different things, sandy soils and seep lines. So they like to grow where there's high amounts of water, so where the water is coming off the crest. You can, if we come a bit wide, you'll see there's actually quite a big grove of them. If we start on the left here, you can see those are all terminalias, and coming around in front of me, all stretching through right past me here, those are all terminalias here. And then you can see on the edge of these terminalias, you get this wonderful open grassy patch, which is really, really productive with great grazing species. So you often find, well, not today, but you often find really nice conglomerations of general game, so zebra, wildebeest, impala. And these areas are the sort of lifeblood of the Sabi Sands, and particularly the north, where we're not on a major river. So it has really nice grass. This is where the underground water is traversing down to start moving into the little river systems that we're going to get down here. This is a tributary of the Mawati that actually starts up here. So the grasses will grow where there's heavy water content under the, or high water content under the ground, and the trees will stop. So a lot of trees don't like that much water. So they like water, but not too much. And where you get these sort of sodden areas, you get this incredible explosion of grasses and also lots of wild flowers and different things here. This is a beautiful vista of what one would call mixed broad-leafed woodland, or combretum-dominated broad-leafed woodland. Off we continue. Oh, must love dogs, says she's very, very sad when the woodlands kingfishers depart. And sometimes I agree, must love dogs, sometimes I'm not so sure. On your one morning off, when you have a woodlands kingfisher 30 centimeters from your window at 5:45, when you think you're gonna sleep in, we always pretend we're gonna sleep in, we never actually manage to do it. And you sort of lie there trying to force yourself to sleep from about 4:30. Doesn't really work. And then you sort of doze off around 5:30, 5:45, and you think, oh, yay. And then there's suddenly, chitter! And literally 30 centimeters from your window, you start saying, okay, guys, go back to West Africa, please. So this is my morning off now, you're disturbing. But no, generally a beautiful call and wonderful to have. And we'll see if we can find some of the last woodlands today. On YouTube, who's in Calgary, said their robins are returning from their summer visit. I presume they go down south, to south or to Central America and maybe southern United States, and they're now returning back up to the north in Canada. And she loves to hear their bird song in the morning. Yes, I think a robin song is slightly less jarring than a woodlands kingfisher. But speaking of robins, we saw, for the first time, as far as I'm aware, on the live drives, a white-throated robin chat a few days ago. And I think we might go see if we can find that pair of robin chats again. Pretty convinced they'll still be somewhere in that Mawati drainage line. We'll wait for it to get a bit cooler, So they're not going to be very active at the moment, and hopefully we can pick up that beautiful call and skedaddle towards them, try to get a slightly better view than we did last time. Since I'm nearly done with my panicum, let's get a new piece of grass. Not quite as tasty as the panicum, but still very tasty. Now, it is called Digitaria. And this particular species is called five-finger grass. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, this one's got 6, but normally they have 5. So Digitaria, obviously digits. So one of the finger grass species. Maybe it's not five-finger grass since it's got 6 fingers. Anyway, let's taste this one. Oh, yeah, there. Not very tasty at all. So this is one of the grass species that is not going to be really heavily fed on by your picky grazers like wildebeest. It's not very tasty. There's not much juice in it. Oh, quite vile, actually. So you do have different types of grass species. And what a lot of those not as palatable grass species do is they actually do hold the soil together. But ideally, you want a nice mix of both. So here we have a different type of panicum, a smaller panicum. So it's not the big one we just had, the blue buffalo grass or blue guinea grass. Okay, so there we go. Sorry, Vim. So you can see that the shape of the seeds and flowers is quite similar. So it is also probably going to be a nice, so much more pleasant, juicy, chewy, sweet. Let's see what else is around. Oh, Vim has spotted a Stenbokki. I haven't even seen him yet. Well done, Vim. There we go. Is it a Stenbok? Yes, it is. Hello. It looks like a little boy. Are those horns just starting to appear? So, one of the species that really likes the tops of these hills and very versatile feeder. They feed off different grass and trees. They actually even get a lot of their water from the dew in the mornings. And but I heard something behind me in there. And they even dig up bulbs and tubers to get water and to feed on. So fascinating little antelope. I think one of the best names, indigenous names or local names for them, comes from the Tswana people. And it's called a Pududuhudu. Now, let's see who can say it. Pududuhudu. VM, can you say Pududuhudu? Pududuhudu. There we go. And it is the name of a small village out on the edge of the Kalahari in northern Botswana. Now, in Shangaan, which is this area, it is called Shpene. Shpene is the Shangaan name for a Stenbok. I'm chewing through my panicums this morning, or this evening, sorry. So we have our first Easter egg clue. The sun will rise on the eastern edge of the clearing. The spittle, where, a crispy fruit tree blooms, and a spittle bug rains from the boughs. Interesting. So you guys are going to have to figure that out one out for me. Now, I wonder which clearing it could be. Do you think it's quarantine, Vim?
Sounds like it.
Sounds like it could be quarantine. A crispy fruit tree. That's the one that's confusing me.
Marula
tree. Yes, but why would a marula tree be crispy unless it's been burnt by a fire? Well, we're going to have to think about it. You guys, let me know your thoughts on where that could be. You can drop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Nathan, who's a new viewer since yesterday and has watched every drive since finding Safari Live. Well, good for you, and welcome to this family, Nathan. Nathan would like to know, how many years of study at university does it take to become a safari guide? Well, Nathan, that's a bit of a interesting question. I did not study, well, I studied law at university and I didn't finish. I decided traveling and adventure was far more fun. But I've been very lucky. I've grown up in the bush, so I've been learning this stuff since I was about 3 or 4 years old. For example, Jamie studied law. James, I think he did a BSc, so a Bachelor of Science. So none of us actually studied game ranging or guiding as it's. So what happens is normally, in normal circumstances, you'll go on a guiding course, and then you will then apply to jobs at lodges, and then they'll take you on as a trainee, and they'll be training on the job, so to speak, to try figure out. It normally depends. 3 months or 4 months of intense training before they'll let you take out guests, and even then they might not let you, so you never know.
There's only one session there, so I'm joining, and then you're also going to be joining, so there's 3 more.
So I just got to call Jamie quickly.
You can first leave me. I'm at Bosco Camp, so I'll go there later.
Okay, thanks, yours.
Jamie.
Standing by.
You looking for me?
Nathan, just to let you know, you're in the lineup for that lock behind Elvis. It's now 3 vehicles.
Copy, thanks. Yeah, I think I'm going to remove myself from the lineup. I will head there a little bit later, though.
Okay, copy.
Okay, so let's continue on, see what we can find.
He's going to put himself out of that lineup. He's not going to approach
it. Buddha Ray says, is there a clearing in their treehouse? Damn, unfortunately not. There isn't. So I still think it's further to the east. Treehouse Dam isn't to the southwest of the property. You got any more ideas, VM?
No, I'm still quarantined.
VM's convinced it's quarantine. Savari Deans thinks marula tree Biffles Hook cut line. Oh, I don't think so. Biffles Hook cut line is our northern boundary. So I think VM might be right. I think it's on a clearing and facing east rather than actually away in the east. And I think it's still quite close to camp. So I didn't catch the name, but someone agrees with Vim that it is definitely somewhere on quarantine clearings. Mick in Joburg agrees that it, with Vim, thinks quarantine clearings. I'm not sure. Vim and I decided we're going to be very sneaky when we hide our eggs. So you can see there's very little general game about after the rain. So what happens is when it rains and you get a nice whoopsie flush of grass like we've got at the moment, all your animals like zebra, even impala to a degree, wildebeest, giraffe, elephants, big herds of buffalo, they disperse over a much wider area. And then once it gets drier, they become more concentrated again. Almost seems like there's, we've seen one steenbokkie and a dove and a roller in the distance. I'm hoping for some ellies today. It would be rather pleasant. We're going to take a little gander down towards the south, seeing if there's any sign of Karula crossing. Well, Aaron on Twitter, it's quite an interesting one. If I had to pick, what would I rather see, a sable or a brown hyena? Which one do you prefer to see? Yeah, I think I do love and probably see, I've seen quite a lot of sable. I have seen a few brown hyena, but definitely not as many as I've seen sable. So I think I definitely go with brown hyena. And I've actually found a couple of brown hyena dens on my home reserve where I get some nice pictures of one of the baby brown hyenas, but it took me 2 days of sitting in the dark quietly waiting at the den because they were not used to people. But eventually after 2 days I had one of the little guys come right up to the side of the car. Now their dens are a lot more messy. A lot to carry. Oh, hello. Sorry guys, didn't see you there. Oh, and it's the guy with the blind, he's got a blind left eye. You can see how he's turning his right eye towards us. So apparently you did see him with a Jamie this morning. Do you think we should put an Easter egg in that mud wallow? I think that's a good place for someone to go look.
I like that idea.
VM likes that idea.
Just under, you're
going to
find it.
Yeah. Well, see, the plan is to, Jamie's got to chase the buffalo away and then go splash around in the mud. Well, not very relaxed, these guys. It looks like actually a buffalo cow behind there. It is too. She's obviously, when they got chased by lions or something, she's been separated from the herd, and that's obviously why she's quite nervous. Let me just double check. It does look like a female. And it looks like a female, because it is a female. Oh, she's not relaxed at all. So she's probably being chased by lions, and that's causing her to be very, very not relaxed. So she doesn't really want to spend her time with a senile old bull. She wants to be with the virile youngsters making babies. And also, when you're in a big herd, it's a lot safer. I'm going to leave them because they are quite jumpy. So well done, Donovan. Donovan, I agree with you, and I agree with you 100%. Maybe it's under a weeping wattle tree in quarantine. Either a weeping wattle or a rain tree or apple leaf. Those are the two trees that spittle bugs often feed off and cause it to rain while they urinate. So a nice little bird party up ahead here. You can just hear them making noise. We've got a... which is an orange-breasted bushshrike. Let's try and get into spot. Oh, darn it, they flew off. There were some southern black tits. And they did a disappearing act on us. Ah. Let's go have a look at those two birds there, Vim. Now, I think I'm going to catch you out. So, guys, which bird is this? If you know the answer to which bird this is, and I think it might possibly be a new one for some of your bird lists, what bird is that? And you can send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. There we go. I've been seeing them around, but I haven't managed to get them on camera yet, so that's quite exciting. So there's a nice bird for you guys to identify, and I think it might be a new species for some of your bird lists. Michelle in Ohio says, at this rate, the monkeys are going to find the eggs before we do without any clues. That is true, Michelle. We're not really doing too well at the moment. So, just a quick update. Jamie is still struggling with gremlins. They're trying to sort it out as soon as possible. So, you're still stuck with me for now. It's a squirrel just giving some alarm calls in there. Just checking it. I'll make sure there's not a predatory bird around. Let's just go forward a bit. Now, this is an area Karula's been frequenting. David on Twitter says, in the city in England, all he gets waking up in the morning is pigeons and sparrows, rather unpleasant. Yes, well, I think in those circumstances, I'd definitely take the chirr of a woodlands kingfisher over the flying rats of the great smoke. So Lael in Washington would like to know, could the late rains delay the migration patterns of certain birds? It is possible, but not by any extended period, Lael. They will sort of stick to the more similar pattern. So maybe a week or two, but nothing major. And there is variance in that migration pattern every year, depending on rain this side, depending on what the food is like on their stopover points during they migrate. So there's quite a lot of variables that go into exactly when do birds migrate backwards and forwards. But it will generally always fall within the same window, give or take a week or two either side.
Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us. Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us.
So we're meandering through, sorry about that, I'm unsure why. We had perfect signal here this morning and also last night, so it is just one of those things about being live in the bush. Sometimes, I don't know, maybe the astronauts are talking to each other and it breaks up our signal. Heading just hoping for a bit of luck, although I said it's highly unlikely Kruder's going to come back to that minuscule bit of dike that's left. We are going to give it one last quick check. We can also see if she actually has been back during the day while we have been gone. See how much of that dike is left, or if something else has found it, like a battalion or a tawny eagle. I would still make quite a nice meal for one of them. That is a juvenile battalier, and he's got the remains of that diker on the road. Look at that. That's why it's always worth coming back to have a look. See, he's found the remains of that diker, and he's carried it away from where it was in case the leopard comes back and put it high up in a dead tree. And speaking of birds, well done to Raisa. It was indeed a pair of southern black flycatchers. So I think that might be one, might be a new one for a few of your bird lists. Isn't that incredible? So tawny eagles, battaliers, they've got incredible eyesight. And they're often the first to spot carcasses way before vultures. Now this particular juvenile has obviously spotted Karula's remains of that kill. And he's come in there and stolen them and flown off with them, putting them in a safe place in case the leopard comes back. You see, quite a windy afternoon. It takes about 8 years for a battalier to attain his full adult plumage. It looks like he's like, ooh, which part to eat first? I'll try slide. Oh, no, it's not working. I'm gonna try just roll down the hill a little bit. We might be able to still. Juvenile battaliers are often quite relaxed, or battaliers in general. So that's why we just stopped a little bit far away in the beginning. And now we're literally right under him. Oh, no, you forgot your leg. Sorry, dude. But he'll definitely come back for that. He's not going to go far. There he goes. All right, so Shane, we're going to just have a quick look at the leg and then we're going to move so he can come back to feed off it. There we go. So he's got what was left of Karula's kill. And isn't that incredible? Nothing goes to waste out here. So Shane, I didn't mean to chase him off, but I'm sure he'll go back. So as soon as we give him a little bit of space there. And fortunately for him, it's still in the tree, so there's very little else that can steal it. Oh, is it Nelson? We have a one-horned impala. Now we just need to see the other eye to check if it's Nelson. Now, for our new viewers, Nelson is a one-horned impala who had a very bad damage to his left eye, and so we nicknamed him Nelson. No, it's not Nelson. He's got two good eyes, that particular guy. Or is it Nelson? Do you think it's Nelson, Vim? Yeah, there's a scar there, and I can definitely see a cataract. I think this might be Nelson. So we named him after Lord... what's it, Lord Horatio, or Admiral Horatio Nelson of the British Army, who, after his numerous battles and whatnot, at the end had one eye, one arm, and one ambition. I think his ambition was to get Napoleon, but our Nelson has one horn, one eye, and one ambition, and his one ambition is to avoid the predators. It's amazing how that healed. His eye was literally hanging out a while ago. And we do worry slightly about Nelson, because sometimes, unlike other impalas, he's not found in the presence of a few others. And he's only got one eye, so he can only check one side. So he's done remarkably well to survive this long. So just a quick update. Jamie has had to return back to camp. The tech team are there poking around trying to figure out what could possibly be wrong with Wendy. I think sometimes she just needs a good kick in the pants, but that's why I'm not part of the tech team. I would probably hit her with a hammer or such forth. I'll stick to my problems being vehicle-based, not magic-based, because it is quite magic that from a little antenna we're able to send a signal all the way to the other side of the world, and you can enjoy the African bush with us on a day, on a daily, twice a day. It's incredible. So Isabella, hi Isabella, who's 5 years old, would like to know whether the Easter Bunny brought us Easter baskets to me and all the animals. Well, they definitely, Easter Bunny definitely brought Tingana an Easter basket, but his Easter present was one of these guys. But he had to work quite hard to catch him. There we go, an impala. But yes, Isabella, and now we just have to find where the Easter Bunny left our Easter eggs. So of course I haven't managed to hide any yet because you guys are watching, and that would just be cheating. Safari Dean says the one-eyed, one-horned impala is a Juma's version of a unicorn. Yes, he is quite. Did you see that, Ben?
Yeah, was it a slender?
Oh, I think it was a slender mongoose. Now, this is one of the more challenging creatures to get onto camera. We will try for you. I think the best might be from the other side of this thicket, Ben. But they are very slinky, a little slender mongoose. Not so keen on being, oh no, it's a squirrel. I saw him run again. No, false alarm, it was a squirrel. You see in that dead quarry closest to us, there's a chagra hopping about, a little bit lower. Come out of it. Right, you got him now. Okay, there we go. So a black-crowned chagra. Oh, you can just see his tail just to the right screen. He might hop back up into that dead gwarri bush. Very beautiful little shrike. Quite a shy and retiring. Likes to skulk in the thickets as he's doing right now. But one of the most exquisite calls out here. Let's see if I can convince him to show himself. Psh, 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 psh. There we go. You can see that very distinct black crown. As it gets cooler, the birds are going to start getting a little bit more mobile, start feeding again, and we could be in for a wonderful evening chorus of birdsong. I'm still definitely going to go see if we can find that robin chat again in the Mawati. Oh, there he goes. Hunting around for insects, spiders, and things. Oh, I'm a falcon's. whole little flock of Amur falcons. Oh, I think we might find a few of them around Twin Dams, maybe a bit closer, just judging from where they're flying. Sometimes you get flocks of the hundreds in this area. And every now and then you gotta look careful. There's often a little western red-footed kestrel that's in amongst the amurs. But from this distance, it's a bit difficult. I'm gonna go see, from judging from where they're flying, if we can find where they're going to sit in a tree for a while. Simon on YouTube is wondering, what is the rarest animal on Juma? Now, that's a difficult question, Simon. Well, it depends what you mean. But in terms of the rarest animal on Juma, in terms of the least times it's ever been seen, I think the two of the front runners are a member of the Hyena Day family. And Art Wolf, a little, would be definitely probably the rarest. The last time an art wolf was seen in the Sabi Sands as a whole, forget Juma, was in the mid-70s. And then brown hyena would be another very rare one. Sable antelope, another one. Sharp's graysbok, another one. And what else, Vim? What else can you think of? Eland. So there's always a possibility that we could see them, but it's just very unlikely. Jules is wondering about Nelson and will he take part in the rut? Jules, probably not. He's at quite a disadvantage with one horn. He might try, but I think how he lost his horn and his eye was in last year's rut. So I think he might be outgunned this year. So I think we're going to check for this white-throated robin chat quickly in the Mawati, and then I think we should go try find our first egg. And I do think we are in the right ballpark, somewhere on the eastern edge of quarantine near a weeping wattle or rain tree. Very clever, Charlotte and Robin. I said, don't a spittle bug rain from an apple leaf tree? Yes, they do. Another name for an apple leaf tree is a rain tree due to the spittle bugs. And don't they have a very crinkly leaf that crinkles and and crackles, and you are spot on. So maybe we're not looking for a weeping wattle. Maybe we are looking for an apple leaf or a rain tree. Oh, that is just beautiful, though. Such fantastic light. And on those kudus, wonderful backlit, big group of kudus. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 that I can see. Sorry about that, just quenching my thirst. It is quite warm today. Here we go, lovely big group of kudus. All moving through from the edge of the river system through to the thickets on the other side. Bye-bye, kudus. So this is the area where we last found that white-browed robin chat. Very beautiful bird. And I'll get a picture of those for those who missed it. Let's just stop here and listen for a second, see if we have any clues to where the robin chat might be. Got a Cape turtle dove calling there. That's what he looks like. And he has a very beautiful call. He did a wonderful display for us the last time we found him. I can't hear any robins calling just yet. So that's what his call sounds like. So like most robins, they do mimic other species, which can get a little bit confusing when you're looking for them. Don't hear any sign of him. So, while we're on our way to look for that Easter egg, just to let you know what happened a little bit while we were tracking this morning. So, we had that report that he had crossed on top of my tracks from earlier in the day. And Taxon was checking up on Twin Dams Road, and he asked us to check down here. And it didn't take very long at all till I saw these wonderful, fresh, big pug marks. And I think they should be still quite nice and clear for us to have a look at now. Pretty sure he dropped down from Twin Dams Road somewhere around here. I found the tracks a bit further, but we should see them shortly. Might have even come down one of these little spots here. There we are. This is did he? I think someone else has driven here this afternoon and obliterated the tracks, unfortunately. Okay, so apparently we're closer to another egg. Not the first egg. So let's hear the clue. Ah, I know this one. Spotter, I know this one. My head. What? Oh, let's just hear it again. Sorry. I was concentrating, trying to figure it out. My pride is broken. My head held low. Mountains watched me and my heaviest foe. VM, do you think you know where that one is? I think I know where that one is.
I think so.
We're going to have to hide an egg for Jamie with you guys with us. Now, you have to promise not to give it away. So otherwise, I think if, just in case the tech department does get it all sorted, and I think I've got a good spot. What do you think, Fem?
Yeah.
Yep, under the archway. There we go, let's go. What should we go for? A cheetah, a leopard, or a zebra?
Leopard,
because it's going to be in a tree.
Exactly.
There we go. Oh, sticky paint. Oh. So there we go. Let's pop that right there. Oh, let's put the pretty side facing out. How's that? There we go. A leopard in the tree for Easter. And because we can talk about it again. Oh, sorry, I didn't get that. I need to get my ears back in. Good. So, guys, I think I know where Jamie has hidden that other egg. Let's see if you guys can figure it out as well. We're gonna start slowly going there anyway. So if Jamie gets out, we'll give her that clue about where that one is. So I wonder if any of our viewers are sneaky enough to know exactly where we popped that. Should have brought a cooler box for our eggs, Vim. I'm feeling a bit soft.
Actually, think we should install cooler boxes.
Yes, Vim thinks we should install cooler boxes on the car so we can have cold Easter eggs all year round. But I think he's probably thinking more of cold all year round. Or hot coffee, Vim.
We can do the coffee machine.
Yes. So VM would like to install a fridge slash coffee making machine on the vehicles. So the fridge for summer and the coffee for winter. VM is a great lover of warm drinks, and he has got multiple cups that are travel cups that have lids. And you often will see VM, well, you won't because he's sitting behind the camera, but VM can be seen drinking a bundle. This steel travel mug while we waffle on about some worthy animal. Hey, AG101 Sun, or better known as Tiffany, is a new viewer who says she loves wildlife and this is so exciting. Well, welcome to the Safari Live family, Tiffany. Great to have you on board with us. And we will be going to hopefully see a big male leopard just now. And hopefully he will be doing something. At the moment, he is still very much sleeping. So we're just moving around, seeing what other incredible creatures or spectacles we can find. And hopefully by the time we get there, it's cool enough that he's decided to go start feeding on that impala that we saw him with this morning. So Vim, where do you think that egg is? Vim and I think we know where the egg is. I'm waiting for you guys. I thought that clue was definitely much easier than the first one.
That's where we wanted to hide our egg.
I know, we wanted to put an egg there as well. But I think Jamie's much better at making clues than we are. Yeah. I think ours are very, very, very basic. Andy and Julia in LA, so they'd really like to see a dung beetle rolling the East Egg. Now that is definitely something I'd like to see as well. That could be very funny. But the thing that would be most excited if it encountered our eggs before we got to them would be one of the social mongoose species, banded mongoose or dwarf mongoose. They're so excited when they find an egg. The noises they make is just incredible. And they get very excited. Now, the bigger mongoose species actually grab the eggs and throw them between their back legs against a stone or a tree to try break eggs open. So really fascinating. They obviously feed off quite a few ground nesting bird eggs when they are scuttling about, and they do manage to find them. So guinea fowl and Franklin and button quails. So no one has guessed where this egg is yet, have they? I think I know. So there we go. I think, hey! Vim and I actually thought about hiding one here ourselves. So there we go, in the eye of the buffalo. Okay, let me go fetch it. Now, which one is this thing? This is the spiderwebby one. I'm not sure what this is supposed to be. There we go. There we go. Well, at least we managed to get one. I'm still a bit confused about the other. So I think it's going to be in an apple leaf on the edge of quarantine, but I'm not certain. What you got? VM spotted something else. I'm not sure what he's got. Oh, there we go. Well spotted, VM. An elegant locust. Now you can see, let me go. See if we can get him a bit closer. Now, is he going to escape? Da-dum. Hello, little hopper. So you can see he can't fly away. He doesn't escape too quickly. And there's a very important reason for this. I'm going to hold him quite carefully so he doesn't lose a leg or anything like that. So I think, how's this for him? Or just do that, I think it's the best. Now look at that. So you can see very brightly colored. And you can see he's got very non-developed wings. They're almost non-existent. And if you do ever want to grab a grasshopper, sorry, he's just being a little bit difficult there, you hold him at the joint of the two back legs so he can't kick, and that doesn't, and that stops him from hurting himself. So you can see very, very brightly colored, doesn't have developed wings to escape. And the reason for that is these bright colors are what you call aposematic coloring. So that is warning every single bird and mammal that he does not taste good. He's got a very strong, pungent taste, and he actually releases quite a strong, pungent smell, almost a chemical-like smell, rather than a bad smell. And so that's how he doesn't get eaten. These bright colors warn all the predators that he is very dangerous. There we go, very dangerous grasshopper. Off you go. But really, really cool, and very, very awesome colors on that particular little insect. Yeah, well spotted, Vim. So Snoop on Twitter says it sounds like Vim would have to stop and mark his territory after all that coffee. Well, he does occasionally, but I think since we found the one egg, Vim and I, we're going to have a, it's a bit sticky, have myself a marshmallow egg a victory reward. I definitely feel that eating a hard-boiled egg takes a bit of the fun out of Easter, because there's no chocolate. Let's hopefully I don't make too much of a mess. Very sticky. Yummy. Okay. Let's see what else we can find. Cry Cat says this looks more like a giraffe than a spider web. I don't know, Vim, what do you reckon? Vim's gonna go with giraffe. I'm going to go with, I don't have a clue.
Could be a leopard.
Yes, a leopard that's been rolling in the mud. maybe a giraffe. I'm not 100% sure. There we go. Then would you like a hard-boiled egg rather than an Easter egg?
I don't have any salt.
No, he doesn't have any salt. He doesn't want the hard-boiled egg either. Okay, continue on. So, update, Wendy is still with the tech department getting worked on, so hopefully she will be out again before the end of the sunset safari. Tech team, however, says maybe I need to hide an egg outside the DRC. I'll camp for her. So hopefully they're joking and they're going to be better than that and get the car out and running, but hopefully Jamie and Dangerous Dave will be out and about shortly. Okay, I just need to be on the game drive channel for a few minutes. Station with Tingana coming. Hi Alan, just looking for an update on vehicle movements in that area. Copy, thanks. Confirm no standbys at the moment.
Anyway, for the first one.
Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us. Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us.
Sorry about that. It seems like we went through a gremlin-rich area, but we have passed it now. Not sure exactly why, but it is getting to some beautiful light at the moment, and we are going to be slowly making our way towards that male leopard. So he was quite full when he killed that impala, so he hasn't been doing too much, and he might have started feeding at some point, but we're going to go have a look now. Hello. There's a squirrel hopping off, but that's not what we're too interested in. There's a little bush squirrel, but closer even to us. Where do you go now? There we go. There he is. Little dwarf mongoose. Quite a lot of them. Not a big business of mongoose. Sorry about the radio, but I do need to listen at the moment.
Crossing Tohoji Dam now east. Okay, good.
Look at that. So there's the little guy we're talking about who throws eggs between his legs and really, really loves that. Birds' eggs when they do have the opportunity to find any ground nesting eggs.
You can come and I will put out the eagle and you can come and join us.
Coffee stations, when there's a gap, I'd also like to make my way. Thank you.
Sorry, Brent was in front of you. Brent, do you
want to
come in now?
FM, I'm on Central Junction, Yala South.
Okay, guys, I'll make my way out. FM, you can come and Brent.
Copy, thanks very much, yours. Okay, so let's go see what Tingana's been up to during the heat of the day. My guess is not too much. Okay, so it seems like Jamie is out and about. Just sorry, one second. Just stand by one tax. And it seems like the tech team has got some signal, so we're going to be moving towards that leopard to see what's happening there, but it's time to give Jamie her clue. Oh. Let's think of this, Vim. It's in an arch above a beach.
That bends the signal.
that bends the signal. It's in an arch above a beach that bends the signal. There we go. Let's see if Jamie has any luck with that. So let's see what she has to think about that clue. Very good, Vim. So off to Jamie, and when we be back, we'll be back with Tingana.
And a very good afternoon to all of you. My apologies for the extended delay in getting out and about. It seems as though Wendy's still suffering from her attack of the gremlins. Dave, have you spotted what I'm looking at here? Oh, you've been dashed away. Oh, that should be a little bit better. There you go. You should be able to hear me. There's a little straggler down there, or two little stragglers down there, calling to each other. A little family of dwarf mongoose. Apparently you were looking at some with Brent. It's a shame, poor Brent. It's not much fun to play an Easter egg hunt when there's only one of you playing. Luckily, we are out and about now. We've got this little mongoose covered in cobwebs and a leaf. And I think that we might be near what has been nicknamed Mount Mongoose in the past. Hello, little one. You've got something on your head there. I don't know whether or not you've noticed. Obviously not. They're termite mound refuges, often play host to other species, such as spiders. Very often when they go dashing in there, they come up covered in cobwebs. And I'll show you what I mean by Mount Mongoose. I'm just going to reposition slightly for Dave. It's all right. Don't stress. Dave, I'm going to turn on the vehicle. He's going to duck back into the hole briefly. Or not. The nice thing about our quarantine dwarf mongoose is that they are relatively relaxed around vehicles. There you go. Look at all of them all over the show on this termite mound. This afternoon, apparently, we'll be playing a little bit of a restricted, we'll be driving in a bit of a restricted area for now. Nevertheless, the hyena den could well be on the cards. And of course, Brent making his way to back towards that Tingana sighting. I did try to get there this afternoon. It didn't work out quite according to plan. Nevertheless, we are back up and running and we've still got a few hours of daylight, or an hour of daylight, in which to conduct our Easter egg hunt. So there you go, Mount Mongoose. The dwarf mongoose all scuttling about there. Almost bedtime, but what a perfect place for them to have settled down. They're all dashing about between where we first looked at them, this termite mound, and then around those areas. I wonder if they've got any youngsters hiding out in there. That is exactly what I was thinking about. So apparently, Brent was chatting a bit about how excited dwarf mongoose get with eggs. I was actually in the middle of telling that story the other day, and I think that I went black screen in the middle of it, so I never got to finish it. But I was in the process of caring for a... Look at that little one standing up there. I was in the process of caring for a banded mongoose that a friend of mine had found orphaned and separated from the rest of the group and had adopted, and somehow it ended up in my care. And this little thing managed to get up onto the kitchen counter and stole a chicken egg. And she was so excited and was desperately trying to scrabble her way into this. Oh, look at that. How incredible is that agility? When you think about the size of those dwarf mongoose and the way that they can jump up an obstacle like that, that it means nothing. But yes, somewhere I've actually got a video of Goose, the banded mongoose, playing with an egg. so they won't be getting, or hopefully they won't find, our Easter eggs before we do. I've got rid of all three of mine whilst I was out and about this afternoon, so I no longer have any. I'm quite surprised that Brent didn't manage to get what I thought was the easiest clue that I could give him. I'll have to go and see if I get his... Apparently he's hidden one for me as well, so we'll have to see if I manage to find his quicker than he managed to find mine. Let's take one look, last look at the dwarf mongoose while I just have a listen to the clue that Brent has passed on to me. In an arch above a beach that bends our vehicle's signal. I know exactly where that is. It's in the Mawati drainage line. The Mawati drainage line with the archway that enters or that goes over it. But I don't know how I'm going to get that without losing my signal. So I know where it is, but I don't know if we can get there. Oh well, perhaps we can. We shall see how we go. Do you think we should try risk it, Dave? We've got a new antenna on the back.
Yeah.
Shall we try and risk it while Brent is making his way towards the hyena, oh, not towards the hyena, then, sorry, the Tingana sighting. Let's just do a quick loop of quarantine. I can't believe he didn't get the egg clue on quarantine. Maybe it's not in the archway over the Mawati drainage line. Okay. Well, there we go. That's a good idea. So if we do lose signal, and in order to prove that we did find the Easter egg and to walk away with it, I will film it and I will show you at a later stage. We better start heading there soon, otherwise we're going to lose light. We'll start making our way across to, to be completely honest, one of my favorite sections of Juma, one of my favorite places on the reserve. This has been great fun, though, thinking about different places. And I mean, this is the best Easter egg hunt area ever. There are so many different options, obviously within reason. We had to do, to be fairly, keep things fairly simple. I could have, you know, we could have hidden it anywhere. I know Brent was talking about seep lines and drainage lines and grasslands. We could have hidden it at the base of any tree. But that would have, I think, have defeated the purpose. I don't think we would have had much fun. I'm not sure if Brent showed you the Easter eggs that the lovely ladies in Final Control produced, but they were absolutely beautifully decorated in African themes. Definitely one of the best Easter egg decorating jobs I've ever seen. Apparently he called the giraffe pattern on the one that I hid in the buffalo skull a spider web. Who is 8 years old. Gracie, happy Easter to you as well. I hear that the Easter Bunny has been bringing you a safari basket this Easter with lots of African safari themed eggs and two stuffed hippos with Bob and Daisy on their t-shirts. Bob, of course, being the bachelor of Biffles Hook and Daisy being his lovely girlfriend. And also a chocolate zebra. That's lovely, Daisy. I'm glad you had I really am glad that you had a good Easter. We've also had a wonderful Easter here. And I hope that you are enjoying our Easter egg hunt. right. I've got to race to my egg before it gets dark, and Brent has arrived at the Tingana sighting. I'm pretty sure that he has let you know about the fact that it will not be a sighting that is open after dark. It will be closed after dark because he hasn't put his kill in the tree yet. So we'll go spend as much time as possible with Tingana for now, and I will race to find my Easter egg.
So there we go. That is a dead buffalo thorn. VM is being very artsy, and there we can see coming into focus a very lazy kitty cat. You can see that bulging belly, and Jamie just explained to you why we won't be staying here after dark. So with spotlights, it might attract attention to this area, and while that kill is still on the ground, we won't be doing that. So hyenas in the Sabi Sands are quite clever. There's been safaris going for so long that they've actually learnt in certain circumstances in certain areas. I've never seen it on Juma, but I have seen it at Londolozi, that they have learnt to always just inspect if there's a spotlight at night and there could be a potential free meal. So we'll be zoning this area, and we will not be letting anyone come here after dark, and to make sure that he has the best chance of eating more of his impala, and hopefully, when he feels the need, taking it up a tree. So what's quite fortunate, hyenas do like to walk down roads and big paths, and there are none in this particular area, so hopefully he will still have it in the morning. He looks like he's definitely got the Sunday afternoon snooze down to perfection. Beautiful big male leopard in his prime. So after a little bit of a leopard drought, we've now had leopard 3 drives in a row. Isn't that fantastic? So I know we've got quite a few new viewers, and if you guys are unsure about asking questions, you can pop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter if you want to ask me any questions. There we go, you can see those bigger spots, the bigger blotches on the belly. Also see how the belly is very, very white. Did he hear something? He suddenly became quite alert, but Kyle, welcome. Now, Kyle's a regular viewer. He's watching with his gran for the first time. So, hi, granny. Oh, no, I think he's just changing position because that belly's a bit full. So, Kyle would like us to give his gran an update on this Tingana sighting. I'm just gonna move forward a tiny skosh. How's that, Vim? So, well, Kyle's granny, this morning, I was tracking him for quite a long time. And then I found him on foot, but he slunk away from me. And then Taxon had a brief visual of him, but then he slunk away again. And then I jumped off and I went walking. And actually I was almost where we are now when I saw him shoot off and grab that impala on foot. And then I had to sprint back to the vehicle. And fortunately we got back to the vehicle in time that the impala wasn't yet dead. And then we watched him drag the impala into the thicket. And then he has been snoozing and snacking a little bit on that impala all day. But he wasn't very full when he originally caught it. So, happy cat. Now, I am hoping he puts it in the tree overnight to keep it away from the hyenas. Otherwise, he might lose it. And you can see it's a big male leopard. You can see the dewlap, that big thick layer of skin underneath his neck. A beautiful sight. Anna would like to know, is it common for leopards to jump down from trees onto their prey? It's not that common, Anna. They do it occasionally, but it is quite a high-risk maneuver. Generally, they prefer to stalk on the ground and then burst out. So they're ambush predators. So they'll generally only make that last run when they're 5 to 10 meters away from the animal that they're hunting. Look at that. He's getting a heavy head. So Vim, while he's having a little snooze, I've spotted another critter right in front of us. So we got a lovely sunset coming through there, but a little bit higher up. And we haven't seen too many of them this year because of the lack of rain. But there we go. There is a golden orb spider. Now, you can see that line of things around the spider, and those are the exoskeletons of his prey species, or her prey species. That's a big female orb. So she's eaten them, and she often leaves those exoskeletons in a line in the middle of her web. Now, there's a very important reason for this. It's so birds don't fly through her web, so it's visible to the birds. Now, if we look quite carefully, I'm trying to see if there are any little kleptoparasites on her web. I might just go forward, skosh. He is fast asleep, not doing anything. And we might be able to see some little dewdrop spiders on her web. Let's have a quick look. I don't want to go any further because of my aerial might catch on her web. So quite often, go down a bit, yeah? Look at that. There is a little kleptoparasite. Now, I will try to find you one of these guys when we're not in a leopard sighting. So that looks like a drop of quicksilver or a drop of mercury. And they're very small, and they live on the bigger spider's webs, feeding off little bits of remnant food that she doesn't eat. And there we go, a kleptoparasite. So there's no benefit for the big orb spider to have these little guys on their webs. And like this big orb, I can see about 3 or 4 little kleptoparasites. And they are incredibly beautiful. They look like a drop of dew in the web, and hence they're named the dewdrop spider. So very, very cool. Let's get back to looking at the leopard though. He's lifted his head ever so slightly. How's that for him? Sorry. Ginny in Virginia is wondering, what is the purpose of the dewlap on leopards? For those who are not sure, the dewlap is that thick layer of skin around his esophagus, around his throat. Now, it has a very similar purpose to what a male lion's... Oh, look at him trying to bite the flies. What a male lion's mane does. So when he has to fight for territory with other male leopards, that loose skin and stuff gives him a little bit of extra protection in that very vulnerable area around his throat. Oh. So those flies that are irritating him particularly are called stable flies. So they're very small biting species of fly that look very, very similar to the common house fly, apart from the fact that they are vicious little bloodsuckers. And, oh, there we go. Oh, yawn. Now, if we look at the back of his ears, you can see there's some bald spots there, and those are bites from flies. And you see, in particularly in older animals, lion, leopard, hyena, how bad those bites get. And quite often you'll see the blood popping out of those little spots. So you'll notice that's why a lot of the predators keep flicking their ears constantly. It's to try and keep those vicious little guys off them. He'll be quite happy night time's coming. He'll have a respite from the biting flies. So we'll be back, but it seems like my clue was too easy and Jamie has found her Easter egg, so let's go have a look.
Well, I think he might just have given it away slightly. I didn't realize I was in the right place until Brent said that, so now I'm going to be looking very carefully. You all know where this Easter egg is. Now, if I know Brent as well as I know Brent, he's going to have hidden it above my head height and out of my reach. And I can see it. Here we go. If we look in between where that fork spreads out, there's my Easter egg, and now I have to retrieve it. And I bet you, and I don't want to move too much further forward in case we lose signal, although, by the way, that clue is a little bit false, because look at us. We're sitting in the Mawati drainage line on Wendy with signal. Is this not terribly exciting? Okay, right. I knew he was going to hide one too high for me. Aww. Okay, let's see how this goes. Oh. Aha, victory is mine.
Well done, Jamie.
Thanks, Dave. And the Easter egg is ours. Sorry?
Quickly to Dingana.
Oh, okay, let's go back to Dingana.
So he just got up and he had an afternoon constitutional and he's now buried his dung to try hide his scent. So he might move back to that impala carcass. And I'm gonna try, see, he's dragged it deeper into that thicket. He's going to go right in front of us, and I'm going to just try to reposition shortly so you guys can see him feeding on that carcass. Yeah, you got him, Vim. Go straight into that dark patch there, as there's just too many... I think a little bit to the right. Oh, no, you got him there. There's just a few too many sticks in the way. I'm just going to see if we get another view. Now, if he decides to carry that carcass and put it in the tree, that means we will be able to stay here after dark. But if he continues to feed with it on the ground, we will not. Thank you. go. Not the best, but you can see the flies that are already in there. So you can see he's moved some of the stomach out. Now, before he puts it in a tree, if he decides to, that large sort of greeny section on the left there is the stomach. He will remove that completely. It is an excess weight that he doesn't need, and he's not gonna really eat. So you can see how he's opened up the cavity. He's eaten the heart and some of the liver already, all the really good bits. And look at all those flies. Now, in this hot day, that meat's probably almost already nearly turning. There we are. Actually, I can see a bit of the lungs still. Just moving it into a better position for himself to feed. Munch, munch, munch. You can see the small intestine there as well, just to the left. So another part, he might eat some of it, he might eat the lining, but he definitely, if he wants to take it up a tree, as I said, he'll remove all those sort of parts. Quite often he will bury them or scrape sand over them, and that's just to dull the smell. Because, of course, hyenas and lions and have incredible sense of smells, and they will definitely try to take advantage if they find this kill on the ground. Beautiful boy. Now, those big blue fly species that we see all around him. Oh, I'm just trying to remember. I did used to know the name. I think they're called a regal blowfly. So they will lay their eggs in carcasses, and the maggots will feed off the flesh. A lot of you may wonder why we only came to Tingana so late in the sunset, on the sunset safari. Now, the reason for this is we pretty much knew he was going to be sleeping during that really hot period from 4 to about just after 5, and he has been. So we timed our arrival to try and get a bit of movement and a bit of feeding action. So looks like we were spot on with our movements today. He already has quite a big belly when we found him this morning, and he's killed this big male impala. David on Twitter is wondering, how often will a cat like this feed? Well, it all depends on what he's been eating, but generally once every couple of days. But there's a lot of stuff we don't see them catching and eating, like little tortoises and monitor lizards and stuff that's eaten very quickly. So it is likely that they might feed or snack. But to have a big meal, probably once every 3 to 4 days. But one must remember, leopards, lions, they are opportunists. If they have a chance to catch something like this, even with a full belly, they will. And in his case, I am hoping he stores it up in a tree. And if he leaves it on the ground, we have such a high hyena population in this area that smell will eventually waft. And will it bring them in? Now, if a single hyena came, I think there's a good chance a big male leopard like this might defend this carcass against a hyena. And again, a lot of that depends on how hungry he is. Is it worth a possible injury? Or will he just leave it because he is quite full already? So another big Safari Live welcome to a brand new viewer watching for the first time, Andrew. And Andrew would like to know, does a leopard smell like a domestic cat? Not at all, Andrew. Unless your domestic cat smells like carrion. So they're quite smelly. They do eat lots of rotting carcasses. Even though they are quite cleanly and they clean themselves quite often, they're not very nice smelling animals at all. None of the big predators are. Very smelly, a sort of lingering of rotten meat is the best way to describe a leopard. So it's not quite as bad as rotten meat, but the sort of lingering fragrance of rotten meat sort of permeates if you do ever get close enough to smell a leopard. Fortunately, their scent marks, when they urinate, smell quite nice. They smell like buttered popcorn. So another new viewer, is great to have a whole bunch of new people joining us on the back of the safari vehicle. And tomorrow, oh, the flies are getting a bit irritating for him. He's trying to bite them. Shame, I think they're a bit fast for you there, big boy. Tomorrow wants to know, will a leopard remove the stomach by instinct or by learning? It is by instinct. You must remember the stomach holds no real nutritional value for them. They don't eat grass, and that's all the stomach basically is. Big bunch of undigested grass. So they will definitely then, probably because they can't eat it, is why they remove it. Oh, he's getting really irritated with those flies. He might move the carcass now because of all the flies. So he's going in for the gory bits there, Vian. I can't see. It could be kidney, could be livers. Could be a bit of the lung. I think it's liver or lung. I can't really see from here. Lung, I think. Just looks at... Oh, no, it's liver. Yum, yum, yum. So nice high iron content, so... very good for a leopard. So they'll generally try eat through those internal organs at the beginning of feeding. So you can see he hasn't really fed, we can't really see it from here, but he hasn't fed much on this carcass. As I said, he was quite full when he started, so he's opened up the stomach, he maybe ate a bit of the heart. Now he's getting down to the bottom end, so kidneys will probably be next to follow once he gets through the liver. Those flies are really bugging him. So the flies that are bugging him are not the ones buzzing around the carcass, not those big blue ones. The ones that are bugging him are actually much smaller, and they're the ones that are biting his ears. look at that. This changed his position slightly. Just wait a second to see what he's going to do. Let's just wait a few seconds, see what he's about to do. I'm hoping he almost looks like he is thinking about dragging the carcass. Nope. He's moving away from the carcass. So, Jamie's got an interesting cameo for you while we reposition.
We won't keep you away from Tingana for too long, but I just had to show you this really stunning scene that Dave and myself have encountered at Treehouse Dam. Look at those buffalo at the back having a serious sparring session. It's just so incredible in this afternoon or evening light with the dust flying. And to see so many Dugga boys together is also quite an extraordinary sight. Just look at this. It is so beautiful. And with the light like this, it's easy to imagine the water has been crystal clear. Let's maybe go back to the ones at the back, Dave. They seem to be getting more involved in their current activities. Getting quite rough and tumble. I'm going to be quiet for the moment just so you can enjoy the sounds of this sighting. Clashing, the splashing of the buffalo, the calls of the starlings. Such a beautiful scene. I love the one that's just watching. Hilarious. I can't decide if he's watching with sort of passive tolerance or if he wants to be involved. Or if perhaps, maybe even better, he's looking at them disdainfully. I always feel as though buffalo are very good at the disdainful facial expression. This is just too beautiful. I have never seen numbers of male buffalo like I have since I started working on Juma. I mean, together in herds. It's very common to see them all off on their own. But to see them in a group of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 is really quite extraordinary. I don't know what it is about this particular area that has them attracted. Perhaps it's the dams. Perhaps it's good feeding opportunities. I'm not entirely sure what it is, but it does make for really stunning sightings. Because I think this is probably, it's not often I've described a male buffalo sighting as beautiful, but this is definitely one of them. Now, I can describe the sounds to you. Oh, sorry, you can hear the sounds yourself. But what it doesn't come with is a way of smelling exactly what it smells like. And whilst it is a beautiful scene, it is very smelly. It smells like a farmyard right now. It's the best way I can think of describing it. Buffalo have spent their afternoon in a very peaceful, contented place. Look at them all. They've all decided that they want to scuffle a little bit. Oh, our two at the back still carrying on. This is why, while we've been tracking leopards in this area, we've been playing dodge the buffalo ball. All right. Lovely sighting, but I didn't want to take you away for too much longer from Tingana. Let's head back across.
So, often people ask us if these leopards really mind being around cars and stuff. And we often say they have grown up, although he was very shy when he first came. But put it this way, he's now laid down directly. Here I am, and there's the other vehicle. He's no more than about 5 feet from me. So, and not looking perturbed at all. Now, if we look at his ears, oh, ah, he's up again. Oh, look at this, isn't this incredible? There he goes, right in front of the vehicle. So he's probably gonna lie up now. It is getting reasonably dark. Oh, there you go, flop. Let's move around. And I was just looking now, I'm probably, in about maybe 10 minutes, probably a little bit less, I'm going to zone the sighting. So that's going to mean no one is going to be able to come in here till tomorrow morning. Because the reason we're zoning the sighting is because this killer is still on the ground. And having spotlights and lots of movement around here could attract the hyenas. And the only reason the hyenas might come in is because of us being there, and we don't want to be the reason for that. So, oh, look at that Scotia silhouette, beautiful. It has been a particularly glorious evening. You can see that orange, beautiful sky behind him. And I've been chatting about hyenas possibly coming in after his kill that's on the ground. And Jazz from North Carolina is saying, what about vultures? I don't remember seeing them. Well, that's why he hid that kill right in a thicket. Because vultures, apart from only eating his kill, and you'd have to defend it and chase the vultures constantly, also, lions and leopards watch them and will descend. I mean, sorry, lions and hyenas watch them and will descend onto that spot if they see them dropping. So Jazz says she can't remember seeing vultures. Well, vultures you generally find on some of your bigger carcasses, such as buffalo or hippo with lions. And we do see vultures quite often. So guys, I'm the only car left here, so I've got to keep the radio on. So the sun is setting. We're not going to put any lights on him, as we've just been explaining. But there we go. Isn't that beautiful? And fingers crossed, he either puts that impala in a tree, or the hyenas don't find him. Still trying to bite the flies. Don't worry, big boy. Another hour or so, there won't be any flies to bite you.
Hey, Bob. I think the branch on rock there, but
He might go off for a drink. There are some pan systems around here. He's going right behind VM. So we can't move the vehicle now. But he's literally just behind VM now. There he goes. So we'll see if he goes off for a drink, we'll follow him to where he drinks and then we will leave him there. So I think there's some pan systems not far, just down this alley where he's walking. But he might not make it all the way there before he decides to have a snooze.
Yours.
Fashions this Wenonengwe is now mobile down towards the Mud Wallows on Inyala Road South. I think he's going to have a drink. After that, we'll be leaving him. Just everyone, please note that this is a closed sighting after dark. The killer's still on the ground, so we'll be zoning it. No vehicles in from now till tomorrow morning. Thank you very much. This is quite common behavior for leopards when they've got a kill. They'll eat quite a bit and then they'll have a little wander to the closest waterhole. And in his case, he's very lucky that it's very close. Sorry, guys. Orbs, Tingana is mobile toward the Mud Wallows on Inyala Road South for a puza. And I've then zoned the sighting back at the Nyama. Nyama is still on the ground. Okay, so there's the road, and he's going to turn right, and the Mud Wallows are just there, so he's definitely going to have a drink. Now, we're away from the kill, so that's why we're still following him. So we're not attracting any attention, and we're not stationary on that spot. So we're going to try to do is when he does get to the waterhole, we'll try get opposite him so you guys can have some spectacular views of him drinking. Oh, might stop for a quick scent mark on the way. Nope. So we've been chatting about those stable flies that have been plaguing this poor leopard and my poor legs. Lucy is wondering, do these flies just disappear at night? Yes, they rest up at night, Lucy. They're not active in the dark, but they're, and also early morning when it's quite chilly. So so I just had to listen to that. So there we go. That mud wall is just up on the right coming up. But you see, so there are diurnal fly species. You, of course, will have some nocturnal fly species, but not, those are not the particular individuals that are biting us, the buffaloes, leopards, lions, hyenas. To hear from another new viewer, Kelsey Teagues. Hi, Kelsey. Kelsey would like to know why the constant heavy breathing. Well, Kelsey, that's how he dissipates heat. So we sweat, he pants. So it's to bring as much air as possible onto the capillaries in his mouth, all the blood vessels. And it cools the blood down. There's the water hole, so he's going straight to it. We're gonna just shoot it around him. Very interesting. Kelsey, the new viewer, is actually Connor the Carnivore, our new tech department's sister. So she's part of the on-site Wild Earth family in the extended way, and she's going to drink there behind the stick, silly leopard. He's, of course, going to drink in the most. There we go. We should get a nice view from here. What do you think, Fiam? How's that? There we go, isn't that stunning? So I hope you guys get some fantastic screenshots. I intend to snap a photograph or three. We're a bit far to hear him drinking. He's just positioned himself in a funny spot. But you can see his tongue lapping away at that quite muddy water. It is sort of that classical leopard pose you see in many photographs, leaning down to enjoy a refreshing drink. And look at that reflection in the water. So hopefully if he stops drinking for a while and keeps still, we might get a perfect reflection. Thomas, another new viewer on YouTube, says, what is the leopard population of Juma? We seem to discuss 5 or 6 different leopards. So in terms of our resident population, Thomas, the resident population, permanent residents, let's call them that, we have this gentleman, Tingana, who is the dominant male in the area at the moment. Then we have Karula, who's the dominant female over majority of Juma. Then we have Shadow, whose territory is mostly on Arethusa and just in the western sections of Juma. And occasionally we get some females moving through who are mating with the dominant males. Female leopards will move out of territory to mate. And so, and most recently we had Tandi, who is Shadow's sister and Karula's first daughter with Shadow and Tandi are sisters, same litter mates. Here we go. Is he going to start drinking, or are we going to get that perfect reflection shot? No, he's moving to drink again. Oopsie. We need to. How's that, fam? I think we're going to just move slightly. Or are you okay? You happy there? So Okay, Vim's happy, so I'm happy. What a wonderful way to end off this male leopard sighting, because if anyone has tuned in a little bit late, we're not going to be following him back to that carcass. Because the carcass is still on the ground, we want to give him the best opportunity not to lose it to hyenas. So we're still with him now because he's moved away from where that kill is, and he's having a wonderful quenching drink at the little mud wallow on Inyala Road South. Diana on YouTube's noticed he doesn't really blink when he's drinking. Well, he's keeping his eyes open to make sure there's no possible threat coming towards him. So you can see, even though he's drinking, he is always checking about. You can see a leopard is an animal that prefers a bit of camouflage. So you can see where he's chosen to drink next to that fallen down knob thorn, offering a little bit of cover. So if a hyena happened to be walking down the road to the right, it might not spot him due to that fallen down tree there. But if a hyena came from behind him, it probably would. Oh, thirsty boy. Well, Laura on Twitter says, I've still got 2 Easter eggs to find. Well, Laura, I might forego my Easter egg hunt to sit with the male leopard while he drinks. And you can hear some of the nocturnal insects starting to make a noise. What we can hear calling that very incessant sound, oh, it stopped now. Behind us, there it starts again, is a katydid, so a species of nocturnal grasshopper. Nocturnal birds haven't quite hit their gears just yet. While we were with him, while he was feeding on that impala carcass, I mentioned that meat after a hot day today could probably already be turning. And Don in Pittsburgh would like to know, when would it be undesirable to eat? Well, for a male leopard, it can be as rotten can be, and he wouldn't mind. I think the only time it is undesirable for him is when it's finished. Up there, look at that silhouette, guys. I mean, not silhouette, reflection. He's going back to drinking again. He's going to muddle up his beautiful reflection again. Here we go, first of the nocturnal bird species in the distance. A little pearl-spotted owlet. And fiery-necked nightjar getting going as well. It's an incredibly still evening. There's almost not a breath of wind. Isn't this just complete bliss, sitting here and enjoying this big male leopard? So Charmaine and Gavin are watching, or Gavin's first time watching. So ex-South Africans who are now living in the UK and really miss the Kruger Park and the bush. And first time watching and really excited to see a leopard. Well, great to have you on board, guys. Welcome to the Safari Live family. And they said the show was recommended by their son, Calvin. So, well, thanks, Calvin. And great to know that we're able to bring a little bit of home to you guys on the Mud Island. So we're going to leave him be if he starts heading back towards that carcass. Quite often he might lie down around here for a little bit before heading back. Belly full of impala and water at the moment. But he's probably feeling quite lethargic. So when he disappears, there we go. We're not going to follow him any further. And actually, he's just lying down there, a nice cool bit of sand. And he's gone down into that little riverbed. I think he's going to lie there for a bit. We'll just have one quick check. And then I think we're going to leave him be. And as I said, we've zoned that site of the kill. And hopefully, when either Jamie or myself, any trees behind us for him?
Not yet.
Not yet. Go to check in the morning. He might have put it in that nice bigger tree right there. But I think he's going to go. It's still quite hot. So I think he's going to go down and lie in the cool sand in this little riverbed. I can't even see where he's gone. Well, he's disappeared. I'm very confident he's just... Let's just have one last peek over the edge here. Very confident he's just gonna absorb some of that cool sand down in the riverbed. He's lying down here somewhere. No. Well, anyway, good for him. He's managed to evade us. Pretty sure he's down here somewhere. We just can't see him. He's probably behind one of these trees. So let's leave him be, and hopefully we'll find him again with that impala in the morning. And while we head off to see what else we can find, let's go see... Oh, hang on, sorry. Before we go away... So right next to where we were parked, looking at Mr. Tingana, next to this beautiful little mud wallow, There he is. You got him then? Oh, well, he's disappeared. There was a little bush baby there. So let's go to Jamie, who's got a magnificent view to show you guys.
On evenings like this, where you've had an afternoon where things haven't really gone according to plan, it's time to just stop and watch and enjoy the sunset. How's the sky? The distant lights of the various villages in the outskirts of our wilderness area, the Drakensberg Mountains silhouetted, and the most incredible clouds streaming across the sky. An afternoon with leopards, and now this kind of view, and a red crested korhan whistling in the background. So beautiful. Okay. Well, you can linger and watch the sunset for a while, but we do have other mysterious nocturnal creatures to find. Oh, one last look, just because that is spectacular. I hope you are all taking lots of screenshots of this beautiful sunset that Dave is presenting you with. I have to confess that Dave and myself stayed with those buffalo until they'd all left the dam. It was just one of the most spectacular buffalo sightings I think I've ever had, just in terms of, no, they weren't doing anything hugely interesting or hugely out of the ordinary. It was just the setting that they were in that was so extraordinary. All right. Oh. Onwards. I don't think I ever got to show you just how beautiful this Easter egg is. Unfortunately, shame, it's got a little bit smudged in the heat. But I never got to show you the one that I retrieved, and I did tell you that the final control ladies had put a great deal of time and effort into painting our Easter eggs. I just had to show you the stunning leopard spots of the Easter egg that I retrieved. Unfortunately, some of it now transferring to my fingers. Here we go. Now, apparently, Brent is on a mission to, as we come to the end of our sunset safari, he's on a mission to find the Easter egg that I thought was going to be the easiest one to find that I hid, and somehow has proved to be vexing in the extreme. Perhaps it was clearer in my head than it actually came across. You never know, that's sort of how life works every now and again. Hello, Charlotte. That being said, Charlotte and Robin have both caught on to where I have hidden that Easter egg. They've both worked out that when I said it was a juicy fruit tree, I didn't necessarily mean it literally produces juicy fruit. I meant an apple tree, well, an apple leaf tree. And I don't know that that was, perhaps I should have a juicy fruit leaf tree. But that got a little bit clumsy and complicated. So I'm glad that we've got some people who are on the same train of thought as I am. And unlike Brent, since he made me climb a tree, I'm going to make him bend down to get it. If he's going to take advantage of his height, I'm going to take advantage of my severe, vertically challenged stature. Angel Lady has said that perhaps after our tree climbing experience, perhaps we should offer up a tree climbing challenge to James when he returns. Angel Lady, I shall think about it. I shall definitely think about it, Angel Lady. I think that's probably the first time that I've climbed a tree on camera, and that's not because I don't like climbing trees. I have climbed lots and lots of trees in my time. I just always get distracted by other things. I haven't just haven't got around to doing it. But perhaps this will be something that is